Permission not to.
Give the roll call, please.
Show you how we're going to finesse that.
Chairman Jordan?
Yeah.
Counselor Chapel?
Here.
Counselor Cogswell?
Here.
Counselor Dahlbeck?
Yep.
Counselor Linnell?
Here.
Counselor Marvin?
Here.
And Counselor McLaughlin.
Will you all please rise and we'll salute the flag, please? I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you. This is a regular council meeting, 1694-95, May 8th, 1995. First item here, citizens' discussion with items that's not on the agenda. Is there anybody here, same thing that I'd like to say that isn't on the agenda? Yes, sir.
Good evening.
Give your name and residence, please.
Yes, my name is Paul Phillips. I live 8 Little John Road in Cape Elizabeth. And I'm here, recently within the last month, the town erected 5 no parking signs on the south side of Little John Road right there. I understand that there was a petition to take a look at whether there was a problem there or not, and I live right on that spot. And although there is a parking problem 1 or 2 days of the year, I feel, and a lot of my neighbors feel, that the signs really should come down and be replaced with something temporarily. I understand the last meeting I wasn't able to attend, but the I guess a notice went out. And what I did, and a lot of my neighbors agree, I went out and circulated the petition. I have so far 18 signatures of homeowners in that area, Little John Road, and Robin Hood and Loxley, and I could have went around the corner. There really is only a problem there 1 or 2 days for the entire year. The first one being the opening day of baseball. The town, the sign that's there right now is from May 1st to October 1st. So the only night that that's a problem there is the night that the PSO plays. And it's just, the signs right there are terrible and eyesore. What I'd like to do is I have a petition which I can give to the chairman. I know it has to go on the agenda and the wheels go in motion, but I'd like to read it for a second. We, the undersigned residents of Sherwood Forest, neighborhood of Cape Elizabeth, Maine, hereby petition Cape Elizabeth Town Council to remove the no parking signs which were installed in April 1995 on the south side of Little John Road from Shore Road to Robin Hood Road as soon as possible. Parking in this area is only a problem one night of the entire year, usually the 4th of July PSO concert. The temporary wooden signs would be adequate if they were enforced. Every year the signs are up, but there's never anyone around to enforce them, so people park on both sides of the street, and that one night it is a problem, but I think if we just enforced it, we wouldn't need the permanent signs there. We are very concerned with maintaining the look of the neighborhood, and these signs are a terrible eyesore, not only to those of us whose property is affected, but to all of us who walk in the area. And your immediate action would be greatly welcomed. I've got signatures of, so far, as I said, 18 homeowners right on that area. I won't go through the names. I have just about all of Robin Hood, most of Little John, some people on Loxley. I know some of the town officers have been either had letters written to them, or I know my wife and the Watsons next door to us have called when the signs were going up. And it wasn't really a major concern until the sign started appearing, and I can assure you it is a major concern of everybody in that area right now. When the signs first went up, we notified the town manager, the gentleman over at Public Works, and the chief of police. But I'd like the chairman to consider it, put it on the docket, and I know we have to come back, but there's very, very strong feeling in the neighborhood that those are a terrible eyesore. As you can tell, I didn't grow up around here. I'm from New York originally, and I don't want Cape Elizabeth, now that I'm here, to turn into another Brooklyn or Staten Island. And those signs are just a huge eyesore. It's the prettiest spot when you walk the neighborhood, you make that turn and you look out on Fort Williams, and now it's just a terrible eyesore right there. It just does not fit the role makeup of this town, and one of the reasons that we moved here was to get away from that sort of thing. And I think we can address the safety concerns that are valid just by enforcing the one or two nights that the problem really exists, and not have to live with a sign for the entire year on both my property, my neighbor's property, and I think there's five altogether. We never thought it was much of a problem, and I used to sit out on my porch when the PSO was playing and watch the fireworks, and other than that one night, that was it. It wasn't really a problem, and I don't think we should have to live with those signs year-round. And when it comes up again, I can have more signatures and letters or whatever you would require, but you can get it back out to us, and we'll do the legwork this time.
Okay. Thank you.
Should I submit it to you?
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else?
Mr. Jordan.
Yes, sir.
Hi. My name is Jonathan Steinman. I live at 16 Orchid Road in Cape Elizabeth. And I have a problem, I guess, with the sewer department. I first reminded that apparently Abraham Lincoln delivered the Gettysburg Address in 3.5 minutes. I think I can talk about my sewer bill in about that time. I was concerned about my water bill. I contacted the Portland Water District. My bill averages about $60 a month, and I thought that seemed ridiculously high. I don't use any water. And when I called, I was told that they was asked how many people live in my household. I said, there are four of us, my wife and I, two young girls. And they said, gee, with your bill, you have a lower bill than most people. You have used less water than most families of two use. There's nothing you can do to lower your bill. You have about the lowest bill you could possibly have. They couldn't figure out any way I could possibly lower my bill. The problem was that, unfortunately, the basic charge for water in Cape Elizabeth is approximately $15, I think, and the basic charge for sewer is approximately $35. Contrast that with Portland, where the basic charges are approximately $6 and $8, respectively. Now, I understand that there are a lot more people in Portland. So, in essence, I was told by the Water District there was nothing I could do. I should speak with Mr. McGovern. And I talked with Mr. McGovern, and he very clearly and logically explained the situation to me, which is that we have a high debt service and maintenance service, but there were a couple of potential solutions. One solution would be that we could charge a lower base rate here in the town and charge additionally based upon usage. That is, those people that use more water would pay more than those people that use less. And that seemed pretty logical to me. But Mr. McGovern pointed out that in situations like that, traditionally, those people, when you're charged more for water, you tend to use less. That is, the people in the town would conserve water. Well, that didn't seem too bad to me either. That seemed like a pretty good thing to do. But he pointed out again that because of the basic charges that the town must incur, we would then have to raise everybody's rates if they used less water to, in essence, cover the nut. Still, that seemed to be a better solution than just charging everybody, even those people that are conserving, presently, a whole lot. Another situation or another solution that was suggested would be that if all or part of the basic rate was incorporated into a tax, a property tax. Now, nobody likes the word tax, but at least property tax is fully deductible. So if we were have the same charge, but have it deductible, in some cases we might be saving 40% just by paying the same amount. In fact, we'd actually be saving more because there would be more people that would be paying the tax because not everybody in the town is on the system. Those people that have septics don't pay anything, and they would now be taxed for something they're not using. But there would be more people paying it, and therefore the basic charge could be lowered, and for those people that were paying it, it would be deductible. However, obviously people aren't going to object to paying a tax for something they're not using. Those people that are not on the system are probably not going to be too happy about paying a tax. However, there are people in this town that are paying for services that they don't use presently. This would be a rather small portion. I mean, for example, there are a number of retired people that have nothing to do with the school district, and they're paying for that out of their taxes. Now, it is my belief that those retirees who are not happy about having to pay the tax for the school system are generally those people that use less water as well. They're smaller families. I think they would appreciate a deductible water charge and a smaller water charge if it were to be a tax. But again, that's a problem that the town has to deal with. I don't have any solutions per se. I would like the council to consider it and come up with either solution one, solution two, or a combination of solution one or two. But I am pretty convinced that the system that we currently have is unfair to virtually all of the users, particularly those that use less water, and particularly the smaller families, those one or two person families. And I would tend to presume again that it would be retirees that use less water than a family of six with a lot of young children, but the smaller families are bearing a lot of the burden for the bigger families that are using more water currently. The other thing, obviously, is to look at the debt service or the maintenance service. I mean, if that's an extra, if we're paying that much more, why? And what can we do to reduce that service without incorporating one or two? And then if we had a potential solution that involved, based on usage, perhaps a tax, and or lowering the cost, I think that would be win-win for the whole town. So I would like the council to consider this and hopefully come up with a solution in the very near future.
We'll take it under advisement. I believe the manager's going to comment and he would like to throw out the clerk.
Mr. Jordan asked me to speak for just a moment on what the actual sewer rates are in Cape Elizabeth. It's currently, the base charge is $31 for the first 100 cubic feet and $3 for each additional 100 cubic feet beyond the initial 100. Just on the other point is the whole issue of charging of sewers has tended to be contentious over the years. As Mr. Steinman points out, a major issue is how high a minimum charge do you have, and how much of your income do you depend on the minimum, and how much do you depend on with the incremental charge. I get a number of calls about that every year. The second issue, a lot of folks are concerned with the readiness to serve fee and whether or not that's appropriate. And my sense is that the council hasn't looked at any of these issues in a substantial way in 5 or 6 years, and maybe it is something that the staff should spend some time on so that at least the council is aware of the different options that are available.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Anybody else? Moving along, reports and correspondence.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir. Mr. Chapp.
Reporting, as I've told you each time, on regional waste systems, and bringing up to date, if I may, tonight. The last board meeting was last Thursday night at 6 o'clock, a special one that we called on flow control and some litigation that we're having. And then we met this morning at 8 o'clock for the Finance Committee. There we're in budget proceedings, the same as the town is. Our year stops at the same time as the town out there at Regional Waste. We'll be meeting again Friday morning at 8 o'clock, and then finally, next Thursday, a week from Thursday, at 7 o'clock, we'll be passing the budget. The budget this year is all based around flow control being enacted sometime shortly, as I hope by fall at the latest. There's two plans now going through, one in the Senate and one in the House. The one in the Senate is an abbreviated plan. We like the one in the House better, but we'll take either one because we are grandfathered. Any outfit that was in business as of May of 1984 will be covered, and we come under that. And if we get the flow control, what a difference it'll make to Cape Elizabeth. Right now, we're going into the next year's budget process with $80 or $85 for tipping fees, and flow control goes through, the board will automatically, through the Finance Committee, lower that to $67. When you're talking 3,000 tons or more of material every year, you can see what difference it'll make for us here. The other thing I want to report to you is on recycling. Probably most of you got in the mail the new recycling posters. The silver bullets are all now labeled for you, and a wonderful part is going to take place this year. Your local recycling committee, for the wonderful job that they're doing, will have an incentive program where if they get their volume up, there's actually going to be some money returned to the recycling committee in Cape Elizabeth. Who ever heard of it? Money returned. But it's going to happen. So thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Anybody else? Yes, sir. Councilor Dalby.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, since this is my swan song meeting, if you will, other than congratulating the people who are going to be taking over, I see Rosemary out there, I know about Jack, and certainly congratulations to Bill. Is he always out there? Yeah, good. Let me just say it's been a privilege to serve. I certainly have no regrets about the decision I made 3 years ago to run for this office. It's been a great learning experience. I certainly know a lot more about the operations and have a lot more respect for the operations than I did 3 years ago. I've also enjoyed working with this council. It's nice to work with a group of people who can disagree, and in a body of this nature, there's always going to be disagreements. And the nice thing is we can disagree. We don't always even know who we're going to disagree with when we start out, but we can disagree and still have friendly relationships right after that, and I think that's super and certainly a lot different than some other areas. I might also say, and there are some of the town staff present, but it's been great to be involved and get to know these folks. I think Cape Elizabeth has an extremely highly professional, highly capable staff from the town manager down, and I would include the school superintendent also, Connie. And it's just been great. So my thanks to everybody concerned, certainly the voters, the council, the town staff, for everything. It's been fun. Believe it or not, I will miss it a little bit. But it's been a very rewarding experience, and I just wanted to make that comment. Thank you.
We'll miss you too, Dick.
I'm sure you will.
Thank you. And I just want to say, on behalf of the chairman of the council, anyway, that I appreciated working with you. I know I haven't always agreed with you, but we're still friends, and that's the way the process should go. And I think you've done a tremendous job with the council. Anybody else? Yes, Councilor Linnell.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. It seems sort of appropriate as we're talking about budget issues tonight. I was up in Augusta today and testified against this the takings legislation, which has been proposed in Augusta. I was concerned about the tremendous budget impact it would have on the town, and I just thought it was curious. I found myself in good company. Kevin Gildart was there from Cape Elizabeth on behalf of Bath Ironworks, made similar comments, and Tom Allen, former candidate for governor, raised similar issues. Chief among them, again, are the impact financially and the issue of losing local control. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else? Yes, Councilor Kongshaw.
I was pointing at Councilor Marvin, had her hand up first.
Oh, she did? I'm sorry, I didn't recognize her. Which one want to go first? Want me to flip a coin or what?
No, we'll give it to her.
We'll give it to her. Councilor Lab.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I should stop letting Dick Dahlbeck go first, though, because he steals all my good lines.
If I don't get in first, I don't get a chance, Jim.
I think you all know I've enjoyed this experience very much. I have some very bittersweet feelings tonight because I really don't want to leave the council, but I just don't have enough time to do a good job at the council and to do a good job in Augusta. It's a wonderful group of people to work with. We've come into meetings and had a horrible row, and then we're out in the parking lot chatting about this, that, and the other thing, and I really respect and admire all of the people on the council because they have that ability to work on the issues and not take them home with them in a suitcase and carry them around for the rest of their life. And I think if you read the paper and follow the town councils and communities near us, that isn't always the case. So we're very fortunate that we have that. And as Dick said, we have a wonderful staff leading us, and that helps an awful lot. I know in Augusta, all the time people are asking me about how did we ever get so lucky to have such wonderful staff in Cape Elizabeth, because we seem to stay out of trouble all the time. And I indicate to them that it is the staff that keeps us out of trouble. We're perfectly capable of getting ourselves into plenty, but they seem to keep us on the straight and narrow. This has been a really fantastic training ground for me to go to Augusta. I learned an awful lot about the issues. We have some people on this council that just are a wealth of information, and I've tapped into them, and they've helped me a lot in learning some of the issues in Augusta. Regretfully and wonderfully, I've been put on the Human Resources Committee, I guess, which means we meet 5 days a week. And so I'm up there every day at the crack of dawn, and many evenings I don't get home until 10 or 11 o'clock. And there's been many nights where my children were asleep and I left, and then I came straight here for council, especially during these budget hearings. And of course, they're in bed when I get home. And I really have appreciated their indulgence, and especially my husband, who's been stuck on the babysitting end of all this. And it hasn't been easy for him, I know, but especially with an infant in the house. But I think the other night was kind of the topper when we realized we didn't have a sitter, and he had Little League team night, which is where the kids try to out-scream each other. And he's the coach, so he had to go with our one son. And so our nine-year-old laid on the floor and read the Chronicles of Narnia while I interviewed people for the P2 committee, and the baby sat on my lap. And it all worked out fine. Everybody was very friendly and happy about it, and the baby behaved all the time except for one person.
It was fine.
Yeah. Bill was a little nervous, but it worked out fine. But my final word is to please get involved. We really need all your help, and there's so many talented, creative people in this community, and we need all the help we can get. And so I would surely appreciate it, and I want to thank you all just for all the support you've given me through the years.
Again, I want to thank you, and I enjoyed working with you, and what have you. Like I said to Council Dahlback, that I know we didn't always agree, but he always was smiling at each other and taking the next issue as it come along. Thank you. Council Coggeshall.
Well, I just want to thank both Jane and Dick for running for the office. We've had very thoughtful, provoking, and constructive discussions all along the way, and as a town, we've greatly benefited from their business expertise. They brought with them the attitude that, yes, government can be run like a business, and maybe it should be, as reluctant as it is to sometimes, but I thank them both for all they've given us, and then to go on to rather mundane sort of things. But it was also very provocative. Was on Thursday, I accompanied our chief of police and our town manager to a meeting in Augusta of the Maine Chiefs of Police and the Maine Town and City Management Association, where they had a presentation on no confidence votes and mandates and regionalization. I found it very informative because it also gave me an awareness of what their concerns are and what the issues we may be dealing with in the future.
Thank you. Anybody else? Yes.
I just wanted to mention that this morning the Friends of the Thomas Moore Library sponsored a breakfast in honor of Jane Beckwith. Jane, effective last week, has worked at the Thomas Moore Library for 25 years. She worked for many years, as everyone's aware, in the Children's Library and now the main section of the library. And it was a very nice event sponsored by the Friends. Bill and Al and Phyllis Cogswell were there as well. And really want to thank Jane for her 25 years of service, and thank the Friends of the Library for taking the time to recognize Jane.
Thank you. Anybody else?
Yeah, Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
I want to thank them both too, but it's getting late. Let's get going.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, likewise.
Likewise what? Minutes of the meeting of 14-94-95 and 15-94-95. What's your wishes?
Move acceptance.
Second.
Moved and second. Any comment? One way or the other? All in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed? It's a vote. 6-0. So we'll move on to the public hearing as far as the general budget is concerned. And what we'll do, I believe the chairman of the Finance Committee, Councilor Dahlback, will outline and give you a little brief introductory as far as the general budget, and he'll also speak on the sewer fund budget, Riverside Cemetery, Fulton Headlight, and the Spooning Church, and then we'll take each item up one by one.
Do you want the motions made before the public hearing, or just a general comment before the public hearing?
General fund.
You want the motion?
Take the motion.
Okay, you want the motion first and then a public hearing? Let me first make a general comment.
Let me just say, well, I didn't know that you might want a few opening comments.
I do have a few opening comments.
Might be some people out there that might have a comment or two.
Let me make an opening comment. That's a general comment. And that is that the bottom line of the budget that is in front of everybody tonight, and if people haven't picked it up, there's a copy in the back. But the bottom line is the same as that was approved by the Finance Committee on April 13th and forwarded to the council for this meeting. There is one correction, however, that has been made. $70,000 has been moved from the so-called overlay account to the school department budget as the result of a transposition area. So I would like to note that that has no impact on the bottom line so whatsoever. The budget calls for a tax rate of $18.60 versus the current rate of $17.70, a 90-cent or 5% increase. Let me personally say that this is not an increase that I like or intended when I joined the council. However, it is necessary, and I think it shows great operating restraint by both the town and the school operation, and let me make one comment to illustrate that. If it were not for the increase in just three items, and those three items are the county taxes, the increase in debt service for the new Pond Cove Middle School project, and the increased renovation cost of the high school, which is something that we all, and that includes the council, certainly pushed because we did not want to see another major project that fast, such as what has had to take place with the Pond Cove, the elementary school, and the high school. But if it was not for those three items, the actual mill rate would be equal to or less than the mill rate of the current year. So a lot of restraint has taken place on both the town side and the school side, and I think people should recognize that.
Thank you. Now we'll open up for the public hearing. As far as anybody have any comments on any part of the budget? Anybody want to speak? Hey, you've done an excellent job.
Sort of a gone.
So we'll close the public hearing and move on to item 138 to consider a public hearing comments on the proposed fiscal year 1996 general fund budget and take any necessary action. Mr. Dahlbeck.
Yes. First, I'd like to move that it be ordered that the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, having held its public hearing tonight on Monday, May 8th, 1995, does hereby adopt the municipal budget for the fiscal year 1996 with gross expenditures of $17,156,347 and gross revenues of $5,096,246, and with the amount of $12,090,000 to be raised by taxation, and as further fix Thursday, October 5, 1995, and Friday, April 5, 1996, as the dates upon each of which one half of such tax is due and payable, with interest to accrue upon taxes due and unpaid after each such date at the rate of 10%. Included and will be copied in this motion are the individual item amounts for the various departments which are contained in the document in front of everybody. And I don't think we need to orally go over all of those items.
Thank you. Do we hear a second?
Second.
Been moved and second. Anybody from the council got a comment? Yes, no? You're listening or you're getting figures together?
No questions.
Thank you. All those in favor of the question, please raise your hand. Those opposed, so vote 6-0. Item 139, to consider a public hearing comments upon the proposed fiscal year 1996 sewer fund budget and take any necessary action. Council Dalbec.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I move that it be ordered that the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, having held a public hearing on Monday, May 8, 1995, does hereby adopt the fiscal year 1996 budget for the sewer fund with expenditures of $1,423,519 and gross revenues of $1,399,656.
Second.
Thank you. Got a comment? Any comments? So I'll understand the question. All in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed, it's a vote, 6-0. Item 140, to consider a public hearing comments upon the proposed fiscal year 1996 Riverside Cemetery Fund budget and take any necessary action. Council Dalbec.
Yes, Mr. Chairman. First, a comment. I trust everybody has found the fact that all these motions are contained here in that proposed budget document. I'd like to move that it be ordered that the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, having held a public hearing on Monday, May 8, 1995, does hereby adopt the fiscal year 1996 budget for the Riverside Cemetery Fund with expenditures of $9,715 and gross revenues of $32,360.
Second that, Mr. Chairman.
Been moved and seconded. Any comment? All in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed, it's a vote. 6-0. Item 141, to consider a public hearing comments upon the proposed fiscal year 1996 Bolton Headlight Fund budget and take any necessary action. Council Dalbec.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I would like to move that it be ordered. The Cape Elizabeth Town Council, having held a public hearing on Monday, May 8, 1995, does hereby adopt the fiscal year 1996 budget for the Portland Headlight Fund with expenditures of $223,922 and gross revenues of $257,200.
Seconded, Mr. Chairman.
Moved and seconded. Any comment? All in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed, it's a vote. 6-0. Item 142. Consider a public hearing comments upon the proposed fiscal year 1996 Spurwink Church Fund budget and take any necessary action. Council Dalbec.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I would like to move that it be ordered that the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, having held a public hearing on Monday, May 8, 1995, does hereby adopt the fiscal year 1996 budget for the Spurwink Church Fund with expenditures of $4,676 and gross revenues of $8,950.
Seconded, Mr. Chairman.
Been moved and seconded. Everybody understand the motion? All in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed, it's a vote, 6-0. Thank you, Council Dalbec. Now we'll move on to a public hearing for the Town Center Ordinance, amendments to the Sewer Ordinance, amendments to the zoning map, and amendments to the sewerage service area map. And what I would like to do is to try to keep it with one item at a time, so we'll start with the Town Center Ordinance, if possible. Henry Adams. Pretty good to call you a councilor. I didn't want to hurt your feelings.
I almost beat Rosemary, but... But she beat me by 987 votes. I got two. My name is Henry Adams. I live on Todd Road. I was the chairman of the Town Center Concept Subcommittee of the Main Street 90 program back in 1990. And if I recall correctly with Joe Foley, that committee consisted of myself, Priscilla Hare, Joe Foley, Judy Dooley, and it was 5 years ago, but that's the best our memories could do. Since that time, the Town Center concept has gone on to the Town Center Planning Commission. From there, it's been to the Comprehensive Planning Commission. It's been to the Ordinance Committee. It's been before the Planning Board. It's now before the town council. There have been over 35 to 40 public workshops and meetings, and I want to stand here tonight and enthusiastically support the town center concept. Thank you.
Thank you. I think that you kind of got me fired up here and jumped ahead, because I believe Mike Hill, the town attorney, was going to make a few opening remarks at the town center.
I'll be with him. I wanted to make a few remarks, and I know Maureen O'Meara wanted to make a few background remarks as well. My comments are, at this point, focused on the non-conforming uses and non-conforming structures section of the town center zone, and Maureen will address a broader range of issues. I want to clarify the treatment of non-conforming uses within the proposed zone, and there are really two issues, non-conforming uses and non-conforming structures. The enactment of the town center zone will make some present uses in this, which is presently the BA zone, prohibited uses. What that means is that a new use coming into the town center zone would be prohibited if it's not a permitted use. An existing use, however, would be considered a non-conforming use. So if someone has a use in the town center zone which is not expressly permitted but is in existence at the time of the passage of the town center zone, that use would be continued as a grandfathered non-conforming use. Our ordinance in 19.3.10 deals with non-conforming uses, and so that section would apply. Anybody that wanted to, for example, expand a non-conforming use would proceed under 19.3.10, which does impose some strict restrictions on expansions of non-conforming use, but that process is available, and anyone that wanted to petition the zoning board for an expansion of a non-conforming use could do so, just as in any other zone in the town. Non-conforming structures are treated differently, and there is a specific section in the proposed town center zone, section 19.2.3.5(d)(4), to be exact, limits the expansion of non-conforming structures, calls for site plan review before the planning board, and this would be applicable if there were a permitted use in a non-conforming structure, and this section would govern the expansion of the non-conforming structure. I guess to sum up, if it's a non-conforming use, the procedure is the same as in any other zone in the town. There is a procedure to appear before the zoning board to request an expansion of a non-conforming use, and whether that would be granted or not, I couldn't talk about today. It would have to go before the zoning board. And non-conforming structures are specifically covered by the town center zone.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We might want you later. Don't run off.
Okay.
Where's Maureen? Maureen, I can't see her.
I had just been asked very briefly to go over some of the evolution of this zone, and just I'll try to summarize it, but I'm actually very pleased that Henry Adams got up, because he was working on this long before I ever started on it. My records go back to the town center plan, but in fact this was something that was worked on since 1990. The town center planning committee was appointed by the town council in August of 1991. In August of 1993 they presented a report to you, in putting together that report. They met over 20 times. They included in that meeting forum two public forum opportunities for members of the public to attend. I'm sure many of you remember that most of the people on that committee are in the audience here tonight and represented not only just regular citizens of the town, but also property owners and business owners within the town center. In November of 93, the planning board was asked to look at the draft zoning prepared by the Town Center Planning Committee and to make a recommendation back to the town council for adoption. And they did that roughly a year later in October 94. They took that year, met on this town center zone almost every month. They also held a public hearing, and their big addition to the zoning you have before you are basically those design requirements, which John Mitchell helped us a great deal with putting together. Finally, in December of last year, the town council held a workshop to look at the zoning and to ask, I think, some hard questions about what you were happy and not happy with. And you met 4 days before Christmas, so I think that shows a lot of dedication right there. And then it was forwarded to the Ordinance Committee, and the Ordinance Committee has worked on it this year until March, where you have the recommendation before you. So this is, if nothing else, something that has gotten a lot of thought and a lot of comment and a lot of opportunities, I think, for the public to find out what's being proposed and to interject their opinions. Just to summarize briefly, why you would want to do a town center zone versus the current zoning that you have right now. If you could refer to the map that you have in there, the area that we're talking about is a larger area than the current Business A zone. And it was defined as a larger area because based on all the research we've done, there are certain elements that you find in most village centers. Those elements are community buildings, key commercial centers, and all of those types of uses are what helped us define where the town center zone should be. Town center zones, community character, village centers are where you find your schools, your town halls, your churches, the hardware store, the pharmacy, and that's how this zone got defined the way it is. So if you do choose to consider this evening, you will be taking an area that's currently zoned Business A, but you will also be including within that fringe areas that are in the Residence A zone, that are in the Residence C zone as well. And you will be taking all of those together and be creating a new zone called the Business A zone, called the Town Center Zone. One of the reasons we looked at the Town Center Zone is in addition to the whole idea of village character, there were some duplications in the review process in the Business A zone, and what this current zone does is it eliminates some of the unnecessary review. So for business owners who are trying to rent out their properties to similar tenants, they will have a much more streamlined type of review process. There's still plenty of opportunity in here for the town's planning board to review items if there's going to be an exterior alteration, if the existing use didn't already get site plan review at some previous date. But it does make it a lot easier for businesses to not have to go through a duplicative review where there really is no interest served by either the business or the town's interest. The other thing this ordinance does, I think, is it makes it a lot clearer to applicants what they're expected to do with construction because you have design guidelines with pictures in them, which hopefully will make it easier for everyone to understand. And finally, what this whole zone is supposed to do is it's supposed to create a village character. The zoning that we currently have tends to create a type of strip linear development that looks a lot like Route 1. And the sense that I got in having the privilege to work for these various committees is that they did not want the area of town, which everyone has been referring to as the town center, to look like Route 1. They wanted it to have a village character. And this proposed zoning is much more in keeping with the kind of zoning that you can create a more village-like character. Are there any questions?
Thank you. There might be some a little later. Council Coggeshall, the chairman of the committee, do you have any few opening remarks before?
No, I think all the points were covered. Thank you.
Anybody from the public like to make a comment? Yes, sir, the gentleman in the back. Mr. Emery, I see you better now.
Good evening. Tom Emery, Chairman of the Planning Board, representing the Planning Board. Just to pick up on some of the earlier comments, the Planning Board did look at this item for the better part of a year, struggled at length to balance design guidelines with ordinances that would be usable and friendly to applicants. And the board passed it on to the council and full-heartedly endorses the ordinance before you. Again, this is came from the comprehensive planning process. A city has a downtown. Homes have a hearth. People have families and a heart. And towns need a town center. And I think through the comprehensive planning process, the residents of Cape Elizabeth have decided and defined this portion of town to be its town center. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else? Yes. LP, I guess that.
Thank you, Billy. Jim Murray, 144 Fowler Road. I just want to thank everybody that's listened to me when I was bending their ear over the weekend, and Maureen O'Mara for taking some time to explain it to me. My only concern is that I wasn't, the rights weren't going to be taken away that I had now, and in discussing with Ernie McVane today and receiving a letter from Mike tonight, I understand that that situation has been taken care of. In answer to Mike, question to Mike on the existing non-conforming structures, you said that's prohibitive, pretty much.
Well, an existing non-conforming structure, it was allowed to continue, but a change to that would have to comply with the requirements in the town center zone. So, a change in a non-conforming structure would have to go through planning board review, but there is a there's a process to do that. But it, so it's not a no from the get-go.
Okay.
Okay.
That was my only concern, that I would at least have an opportunity to go to the planning board and to go to the zoning board if it was necessary. Otherwise than that, I have no problem with it, and I know I'm a sort of a rose between two thorns over there, but I'm not going to apologize for it, and I'm going to be there for a while, and I hope my son continues and my grandson. So, thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else? Nope. Gentleman in the back.
My name is Randy Blake. I live on 2 Ivy Road. I'm here representing the interest of Mrs. Constance Riesch, who owns property at 351 Ocean House Road. I have a letter I would like to pass out to the town council. I have represented Mrs. Reese's interest in the property at all these public hearings that have been talked about tonight. I have not seen a lot of changes from some of those public hearings to the original plan. I'm here to focus on a couple of key issues, and Mrs. Reese has retained the services of Gary Vogel of Black, Lambert, Coffin, and Rudman in town. And Mr. Vogel has prepared a letter which he's asked me to read here tonight, and I would like to do that. I have been asked by Mrs. Constance Riesch, owner of property located at 351 Ocean House Road and designated as a local historic structure in the town center plan, to provide you with my comments concerning the proposed amendments to the town demolition ordinance. Mrs. Riesch is unable to attend tonight's hearing. Richard Blake, whose wife is Mrs. Reesch's niece, will make a few comments on her behalf. And then Gary writes, I have had substantial experience involving historic preservation ordinances, historic preservation amendments to demolition ordinances, and have addressed many of the issues which frequently arise before local boards of appeal Maine Superior Court, Maine Supreme Judicial Court. I've also been successful in obtaining judicial determination that the City of Portland's historic preservation ordinance resulted in an unconstitutional taking of a client's property, a result we all wish to avoid here. And there is that discussion going on at both the federal and state level right now. The ordinance amendment being considered by the Town Council this evening, while worthy in its goals, suffers from a number of serious flaws. The ordinance merely provides for a notice period before a demolition permit is issued. The ordinance does not suggest what may happen at the expiration of the notice period. This places the local code enforcement officer in a difficult position involving such matters as these, which are often controversial. Much better practice is to set forth in the ordinance what happens at the expiration of the 45-day period, what items are required in order to prevent the demolition permit from being issued. This clearly provides a code enforcement officer with a basis upon which to act, and is also a better, as a matter of public policy, as it enables all participants to clearly know what is required if they wish to proceed with a, or prevent a demolition of such a historic structure. I would suggest that the proposed ordinance be further amended by adding an additional language, and he's basically saying there that at the end of the 45-day period, the demolition permit shall be issued unless the owner has withdrawn the demolition permit application or unless the code enforcement officer is served with a court order prohibiting or enjoining the process. The proposed language also makes it clear that anyone opposing the demolition must either negotiate with the property owner or obtain a court order in order to prevent the demolition. It is manifestly unfair to allow someone opposed to the demolition to prevent the demolition merely by notifying the code enforcement officer of their objection. Were that the standard to be applied by the code enforcement officer, it would be to force the property owners to go to court just to obtain a demolition permit on property that they own. Someone who opposes the demolition should be required to do more than spend 32 cents the cost of a first-class stamp in an order to prevent a demolition order from being issued. I would also recommend that the proposed ordinance expressly provide that the 45-day period shall not apply to any permits other than demolition permits with respect to locally historic structures designated in the town's center plan. Additional language will enable the code enforcement officer to issue permits for alteration, repair, or to move such structure without requiring owners to be subject to the 45-day notice. Although the ordinance does not require any such notice for such actions, because these matters can be controversial, in my experience, it is best to spell out the responsibilities for the benefit of the code enforcement officer, the owners, and other interested parties. Such clarification can be accomplished by inserting the following sentence. No notice shall be required for the issuance of any permit relating to a locally historic structure designated in the town center plan other than a demolition permit. I regret that I cannot attend the public hearing this evening. I thank you for listening to these matters. Gary Vogel. I think those are reasonable amendments to the section of the plan that deals with historic structures. I should conclude by saying that Mrs. Reese has no intention of demolishing the property. However, it has been in the family for a number of years. However, as you sit there and look at that property, you have encroachment of the commercial zone with a real estate office on one side, a farm stand on the other, a school in the back, and a very busy road up front. All of those things make it less and less desirable for single family use. We don't know what the ultimate best, highest and best use of the property will be in the years to come, and we hate to see our flexibility restricted by the ability of one person to prohibit either a move or a demolition if that is the best use of the property by just issuing a stamp. Mrs. Reese would like to maintain the property, would like to maintain it there. I think her second choice, if she wants to retire the property and that's not the exact location, she would probably move the property. That would probably be the most likely use. We don't know the structural condition of the property at this time. It's very old, the timber frames still have the back on them. We don't know the extent of dry rot and whether, if it was ever to be rehabbed for other use, whether that property is feasible for that, it's undetermined at this point. Making just two simple recommendations for changes to the ordinance, which I think gives the property owner some right, clarifies the process for the town and other interested parties, and I hope you would consider those changes as you consider the town plan. We're generally in favor of the town plan. It does a lot of things. It's a very busy street. Sidewalks should be help there, and it does make the property more usable for other than residential use, which is very not attractive at this point. Thank you.
Thank you. Rosemary.
Thank you, Mr. Jordan. I was on the Town Center Planning Committee, and I was a member, I was a school board member at the time and represented the school. So I would like to draw your attention to page 3 and ask a question on 6.5, and I'll also reference D1 and 2. I just came from a ball game at Kennebunk High School, and they had a satellite dish in the rear of the school, which was extremely large, but was used in their educational programming. I was wondering, the phrase, except for exclusive municipal uses, if that could not be broadened to include school uses, since in item D1 and D2, we specify school uses and municipal uses as distinct. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, Mr. Murray.
My name is Gerald Murray, and I reside across the street, as you most know. I sat in on the Town Center Committee. I was invited to, and I basically liked the concept of what was presented here tonight. But I see it's changed a few times since I left the committee. If I had two choices over BA or the Town Center, it definitely would be the Town Center. It's a big jump forward. As you probably know, I live at 317 Ocean House Road across the street. My father had the ancestors lived on this side of Ocean House Road, and unfortunately my mother's ancestors farmed the schoolyard across the street for many years until the schools blossomed. And then approximately 25 or 30 years ago, the town adopted a BA zone. It made us, me in particular, feel limited. I was non-conforming. All those residents were non-conforming. I happen to own 4 residential buildings occupied. And when you have these public hearings, I've always felt intimidated in the fact that my representation compared to other areas at Broad Cove or Eastfield or whatnot is limited, because not only are residents being eaten up, but four of the residents right adjacent to this, right across the street from this building, I happen to have to represent. The one section that I hear tonight that really, really upsets me no extent is 15 years ago is this residential square foot area of a house lot. And let me backtrack a little bit. When they adopted the BA zone, we were limited to what we could do. I knew that, but I always had the thoughts of not only fixing this lot up, considering what it looked like when I purchased it. It used to be the oldest farmhouse in the town, right across the street, the Hannaford House. I groomed the lot, and I had expectations of building myself a little castle for myself, a wooden structured house. I came across the street, all gung-ho, 15 years ago, and Mr. Daigle was building inspector, and I laid out my plans, and he says, "Don't even think about it." And you know, basically, I thought about it, but I haven't done anything about it, and I maybe lost a lot of interest in it. But looking at the new ordinance, I like the Town Center concept of being a friendly village. I know it thoroughly, as I say, I sat there for over a year listening to all these different entities. But and they did include, after a fashion, mixed growth, including residential, which as you may know, at night after 5 o'clock in the winter, things pretty dark up here. Christmas, you only see a few Christmas lights, so obviously 100% BA or as a BA zone is, I don't think is very friendly, you know, especially at night. But looking at, so you are making one step in this town center concept by allowing residences now to be part of the community, not stuck out in a non-conforming area where we're being eaten up. But reading further down on other uses, it now tells me that I can build apartment houses at 7,500 square feet, or I can buy an apartment, 7,500 square feet. But if I want to build a residence, I got to have 80,000 square feet. That's over 10 times. And I realize there's some restrictions on the apartment. In other words, they got to be related to business area on the ground floor. But I think it indirectly is saying that there's only one area that would even come close to being able to have a private single-family dwelling on it. And it's the Robinson area, which just came to be in the BA zone, wasn't always in the BA zone. I don't know whether Mrs. Hill's property has enough square. That doesn't make any difference. My point being, I would like to have the council look at the square foot area, be it 20,000 square feet, 40,000. But I don't think 2 acres. I mean, I have over an acre and a half of vacant field over there. 1.2 acre, excuse me, not an acre and a half. And I think that that's a pretty large lot. And the other alternative would be to tear down the structures and put one house there. Well, that's not very friendly to the community, having one house with all that vast area. You're going to have a corridor similar to you got in front of the old urban station, you know, where it's just a walk-through. So I wish you'd consider that area, that section. And it would make me feel a lot better because I've lived with this a long time, and it's frustrated. And I made a vow when I sat on the committee that I would have very open mind, cool, calm, collective, because we discussed different areas and we shifted from one side of the road to the other in each different meetings. But I don't mind the green area, and I like green area, and I like to see green area. But I would also like to be able to use my property properly, because I don't know how many of you realize, but BA zone, there's no industry that doesn't go. There's no want for the BA zone, in my opinion, because anyone coming out to this bedroom community, it's a dead end street, and they're going to go buy two of whatever could possibly be out here. And 15 years ago, when I acquired some of the property, there was a lot of real estate interest, there was a lot of bank interest, and all this stuff has waned in the development of electronics and things of this nature. And I personally haven't seen any interest in commercial property, and I'm not so sure that I'm interested in owning commercial property. I just like to have a little flexibility in what I do have. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else? Nobody else has a comment on. Okay, thank you. Councilor Coggeshall, you have any comments that you would like to throw out as far as town center zone? Or?
Well, perhaps the council should, are there any of these amendments the council wants to consider this evening? Or do we consider them later as an amendment to an approved ordinance once we've had time to really go over them thoroughly? I mean, one of these was just presented tonight, and I know we always hesitate to just automatically accept something that evening.
Councilor Linnell.
Well, I think Councilor Coggeshall makes a good point. There's a couple of things that I would like to kick around before we vote on it, because not to decide is to decide. And so there's a couple things I'd like to look at. And one of them, I have a question for Michael Hill, if I could. Looking at the letter from Ernie McVane to Jim Murray.
Yes.
How binding is that?
In terms of the non-conforming use?
Right. Well, it says, you know, the expansion of the existing office and conversion of a residential dwelling to office use is and will continue to be permitted. And let me back up again to the first sentence. It says, business use will continue to be permitted. I mean, sometimes shall is a little more powerful, but I'm just wondering, for example, if, take a look, if, you know, if Ernie McVane, for example, moved on and became a code enforcement officer somewhere else, and there's a new code enforcement officer hired, might this be reversed?
Well, that
policy, or
yeah, that policy is not binding upon the town or a successor code enforcement officer.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, you try and strive for consistency. I think Ernie does an excellent job as code enforcement officer. We hadn't had an opportunity to discuss the non-conforming uses section. So that particular letter, it really is not binding in nature. It didn't act on any particular item, so I'm not really concerned with the binding effect of it.
Okay, thank you. That's all for now.
Okay.
A couple other, if I may, a couple other concerns I had. I was just thinking out loud. I think Rosemary Reed made a good point about the satellite dishes and possibly outlining that or specifying that they could be used for school use. And my other concern is the folks at Jonesy's. We got a letter from the folks at Jonesy's expressing an interest that, you know, it's kind of tough to be limited to how many pumps they have. And I guess I see that and the issue that Mr. Murray has is as far as being sort of zoned out of some of his the possibilities for expansion in the future. It seems to me there's certainly something we should think about. Is part of the intent of the town center zone is to encourage, recognizing that there will be development in the future of some kind, that we would, rather than have it in a haphazard fashion all over town, that the idea is to encourage it within the town and within the town center rather than in such and such a neighborhood. And I know if, for example, Mr. Murray wanted to have an office building at his property next door, it would constitute an expansion of his business. And while it may be, you know, while as long as Ernie McVane is here, I think the spirit of the letter is protects his interest. But if he, if Ernie McVane, you know, moved on or something, there's some exposure there. And if, in the interest of keeping business in the town center, I think that the restrictions on the Murray property and on Jonesy's is at cross purposes with the intent of the town center zone. For example, you know, at one point it was suggested that Mr. Murray, if he wanted to expand, go down to his gravel pit on Fowler Road. And, gee, I wonder, you know, that's not exactly in the town center zone. So I'm just wondering if we ought to take a look at that and not, these businesses have been around a long time, and I don't mean to say that. I know I was corrected one time by the town planner that there's no clause in the ordinance that says if you're a 30 or 40 year resident, you somehow that carries weight. But I point that out because it seems to me that here are a couple of businesses that have been in the town for a long time, and they've been good businesses through thick and thin. And if there were any expansion to their businesses, in which they would have to meet other criteria in terms of zoning and so forth, it would only bring more tax revenue to the town. And these are, in my view, these are businesses that have been good for the town, haven't caused us any problems. And if we are generally, if some of us want to be friendly to business, I think sometimes we should look in our own backyard And I'd like to look at those particular issues further, and if we're going to vote tonight, I'd like to perhaps have three amendments that treat those issues separately.
Thank you. Anybody else? You want to comment? No?
I just wanted, I guess, as far as Mr. Murray's concerned, his Jerry Murray, right, Murray here, what he will be allowed to do under the new town center zone is far more than he can do now. So that you're talking about encouraging and expanding a use, that is what is recommended. Perhaps Ms. O'Meara wants to make a comment as far as the gas station, but I believe they participated in a lot of this discussion, and a lot of this was drawn on their comments and what their future plans hope to be.
On the gas station, the current zoning, the proposed zoning talks about fueling points and number of pumps, and we base that, actually, I called George Jones, and he's the one that helped me out with the terminology, and the intent when the Town Center Planning Committee drafted it was, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, Councilor Chappell, was that what was existing seemed appropriate for a town center, but there was a concern, and I think all of you can think about the very large service stations that you can find on places like Route 1 that have several islands with multiple pumps, and there was a real decision made that that probably was not appropriate for the town center area. While it was appropriate to have a gas station that maybe didn't need to be the same size that serves the same number of customers as a gas station that's on Route 1 or near an exit of 95. So that's why those limits have been placed on there, and they were intended to permit the extent of a business that Mr. Jones is currently running. And just, I hope Mr. Murray doesn't, Jerry Murray doesn't mind, but just to clarify, I think what he was requesting was that the minimum lot size for a single family home be reduced. The current proposal requires that a minimum lot size be 80,000 square feet, and I think his request was that it be reduced to 40,000 square feet. And I don't want to put words in his mouth, and I'm not saying, yeah, I'm not saying it's good or bad, but I think that's what he was trying to get at.
Thank you. Anybody else?
Just if I might for a minute, Mr. Chairman, I would like to comment on the code enforcement letter to Councilor Cogsell regarding Leland P. Murray's request. One of the real difficulties is Ernie, as the code enforcement officer, is often asked to answer questions based on hypotheticals. In the real world, when proposals actually come in, they don't always exactly fit the original hypothetical answer. And he needs to be extremely careful when he answers any question when he doesn't have an application in front of him. So, you know, while I think there's a very clear intent in what he says, and, you know, while that would provide a lot of guidance to Ernie in the future, to any future code enforcement officer, it all depends on exactly what is proposed. You know, I've learned in the years I've been here, something can seem very, very clear, and then someone points out another section of the ordinance. Well, what about this section? What about that section that might not even be in the town center area, might be somewhere totally different, that issues get a little more complicated. So my point is, you know, we just need to be very, very careful with assurances and those types of letters when we don't have a specific application in front of us, not only with this proposal, but any proposal that comes forward. Everything seems to develop wrinkles as time goes on.
Thank you. Yes,
Councilor Cogsell. Perhaps what this letter should say, and it doesn't reference the letter that he sent to Mr. Murray, which told Mr. Murray that he wouldn't be able to have any appeal process at all. And after discussion, he realizes that was not true. So he should really have referenced the letter he sent to Jim last week saying that he had said there was no appeal process. In this follow-up letter, he says there is an appeal process available. So that is the origin of the whole letter, because that was Mr. Murray's primary concern. There being no comments from anyone else, I'll make a statement. that I would like to see us proceed with the ordinance as presented tonight, with a possibility of, in the future, for a clarification as to the historic structure section, taking into consideration this letter we received from Mr. Blake tonight. But it's better that we have something in there, which some of his objections really are already dealt with, but not in the same language, except that it specifically says that it would be issued, but it just says that it has to be on hold for 45 days. Also part of this town center zone is an addition to the definitions, one which deals with adult businesses and the banning of adult businesses. We have done considerable research, our attorney and our town planner has submitted many pages of material to all of us as the council. I want to poll each one of the councilors to see whether or not you have reviewed this material that's been presented to us. Mr. Linnell?
I have reviewed the material, thank you.
And, please don't thank me.
I've reviewed the material, and it's pretty serious stuff, and I understand it, and
you're lucky.
Thank you.
Jane?
Yes, I've reviewed the material.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, I have reviewed the material.
Mr. Chappell?
Oh, yeah.
Mr. Dalbeck?
Unfortunately, yes.
And I also have two. So that being the case, I want to read the following findings of fact. Number one, the town council has had available for review many reports from other municipalities and cities which have studied the secondary negative effects associated with adult businesses. For example, increased crime, reduction in property values, and certain health hazards. The town council finds that these secondary negative effects, which are directly contrary to the purpose of the town center zone and the reason why the proposed town center zone prohibits adult businesses. Two, only 40 minutes south of here, the city of Portsmouth, New Hampshire, studied the threat to health, safety, and welfare of its citizens caused by these adult businesses. The town council finds that, based on the city of Portsmouth's study, adult businesses can be detrimental to the health and safety of the public. Number three, a 1980 Minneapolis study on adult businesses found a close association between adult businesses and crime rates, including robbery, burglary, rape, and assault. A 1978 study in St. Paul, Minnesota, concluded that there is a statistically significant correlation between the location of an adult business and neighborhood deterioration. A 1987 study in St. Paul also found that adult businesses have serious adverse impacts upon the surrounding neighborhood and including property values. Number four, in addition to the above stated reasons, the unique characteristics of the town of Cape Elizabeth support a ban on adult businesses in the town center zone. Our town is primarily residential. It is located on a peninsula, and in order to travel to many neighborhoods in the town, one has to travel through the town center zone. The town center is the only shopping area in the town. It is where our municipal buildings, library, and schools are located. Thus, almost every one of our citizens would have to be subjected to the secondary negative effects outlined on their way to and from work, shopping, or conducting public business. A primary concern is that all our schools are located in the proposed center zone and that our children should be protected from the secondary negative effects associated with adult businesses. Number five, finally, the town council finds that because the town is on a peninsula, all citizens have to travel through either Scarborough or Portland, South Portland to get here. These neighboring municipalities regulate adult businesses, and non-obscene adult businesses are permitted uses in certain areas. Thus, this ban in the town center zone does not have the effect of unreasonably limiting free speech or alternative locations for adult businesses. Therefore, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a motion.
Well, I think before we make a motion, we've got to take care of the amendments to the sewer ordinance and the zoning map, because that's all tied with item 143.
Okay, were we considering those all separately?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay.
Ms. Maury.
So therefore, we'll move on to the amendments to the sewer ordinance. You've got some opening remarks for that?
As part of the new town center zone, it was recommended that all new construction have access to the town sewer. And in order to have access to the town sewer, we have to designate the town center as a growth area, change the sewer ordinance, and the sewer service area map. The section that deals with the sewer is section 15.14F. So that takes care of all those.
Has anybody got any comments as far as the sewer goes?
Norman Jordan. I live at 359 Ocean House Road, which is, are these maps being moved from residential to your town center? And you're putting me into the expansion of sewer service area, along with most of your athletic field in back of me, I notice. And my concern is that, are you going to start charging me for those two lots to have the sewer go by after I just spent $4,000 to put a septic system in?
No.
That's good.
That's what Michael said. I was just...
No, the council several years back had an availability charge for vacant lots, and it was dumped very quickly.
Yeah, and the house, one of the lots that wasn't vacant is my house. And couldn't go on it then, so I don't see how I could go on it now anyway.
Well, there won't be any fee.
I guess that's the only real question I had. I had a lot of other, I don't really know if I want to be in the town center plan or not, but I think they have answered a lot of questions here tonight. With that back, I think this is backtracking some, but what about this 80,000 square feet? That's 2 acres on a house lot. Now in an RC, I think it's down around a half an acre. At least they taxed me for a house lot. Which, is this going to mean that you will no longer be able to tax me for a house lot?
If you'd like me to respond to that, I would suggest you take up that issue with the assessor. He determines. No,
Which means I'd have to go hire a lawyer again.
No, it's not chicken. The assessor makes those determinations, and I would think you'd want to point out to him the ordinance provision and how it affects your property.
All right, thank you.
Okay, anybody else? Therefore, then we'll move on to the amendments to the zoning map.
We've already done that as part of the...
Okay, well, you got an item down here. I'm just reading the items off. So you felt the town center zone would cover the zoning map amendments? Okay. Amendments to the zoning service area map. That'll take care of that also.
Mm-hmm.
Oh. You agree with the agenda?
Make a motion.
Item 143. I will close a public hearing and move on to item 143 to consider a proposed amendments to the zoning ordinance, which would establish a town center zone and related amendments to the sewer ordinance, the zoning map, and the sewer service area map, and take any necessary action.
Also, Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
I move to adopt the town center zone, the zoning map amendment, the growth area designation, and related amendments to the sewer ordinance. Whereas the purpose of the town center zone is to encourage an identifiable town center including a village feeling with a mixed retail and residential uses to serve our citizens, and whereas it is further purpose of the town center zone to provide a common meeting place, inviting to pedestrians and visually cohesive, and whereas numerous statistics and studies performed in a substantial number of communities in the United States, summaries of which are contained in the record before the town council, have confirmed that adult businesses as defined in the proposed town center zone constitute a public health risk and would have an adverse impact on the public safety, welfare, and property values. And whereas, based upon the unique character of the town, namely its overwhelmingly residential character, its geographic configuration of being a peninsula, and the town center zone containing the town's only shopping center, the library, municipal buildings, and all our schools, adult businesses would have a detrimental impact on the public health, safety, welfare, and property values. Whereas the town council finds that the proposed town center zone is in basic harmony with the town's comprehensive plan, now therefore be it ordained that the town council of the town of Cape Elizabeth, Maine, hereby approves and adopts the proposed town center zone of ordinance, section 19.2-3.5, the proposed amendments to section 19-1-3, section 19-2-3, and section 19-4-2, the official zoning map amendment and related amendments to the sewer ordinance, section 15-1-4F, and designate the town center zone a growth area consistent with the comprehensive plan and amend the public sewer plan, all as recommended by the ordinance committee on March 30, 1995.
Michael.
I'll second that motion.
Been moved and seconded. Anybody got any comments? Yes, Councilor Linnell.
Yeah, I just wonder if we could amend the motion to address some of the issues that we've been brought up tonight. For example, the single-family lot size. I'll start with that one.
What's the other one?
To amend the single-family lot size in the town center zone to 40,000 square feet.
Anything else?
Well, I'd like to do them separately. I wouldn't want to, I don't want necessarily to lump them all together, but yeah, I can describe them now, but.
I think you ought to describe them now.
Okay. So. The other one is to address the concerns from Jonesy's as far as the fueling points and the car wash that he identified in his letter. The other one is, I'm not finding any fault with the code enforcement officers. Work as far as his letter to Mr. Murray, but as I see it, it's not binding. And so I'd like to see it amended so that Mr. Murray's business would not be non-conforming. And finally, to amend it such that so satellite dishes, which would be if they're used for school purposes, although I'm not necessarily sure we want a lot of TV in the schools, but so that they'd be, that would be included.
Thank you. Anybody else? I would like, yes, Councilor Marvin.
I do have some concerns about the points that Mr. Blake brought up this evening. I wonder if maybe we would be wise to table this evening in light of Councilor Linnell's issues too, and go back and put this together again. I think it's a fine piece of work, but all these factors combined, maybe we need to go back to the drawing board just one more time.
Anybody else? I would like to see it get back, and these points that were brought out tonight, especially the one that was brought out about the, the house lot size and the letter that we got from Randy read up from, let me get her name straight or I'll screw it up. Rice, Constance V. Rice, I think that ought to be looked at. And I think these things could be brought to the next council meeting, and I don't believe in amended ordinances with these substantive amendments until we have them in the ordinance. So. Michael Hill would like to run me down, go ahead.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I won't run you down. I just wanted to make a comment regarding Gary Vogel's letter about the issuance of a permit for demolition. The proposed ordinance change does not, as is suggested by the letter, allow someone to stop a building, a demolition permit from issuing merely by 32-cent postage stamp and a letter. The burden would be on anyone who objected to the demolition permit to go to court or in some other fashion stop the demolition permit. I do agree with Mr. Vogel that it's always your best to deal with any issues up front in the ordinance and make it clear. But this ordinance as written just provides for notice. It doesn't say that the code enforcement officer cannot issue a demolition permit if he gets an objection. So perhaps the language could be improved, but I don't think that the concerns that are raised by Mr. Vogel's letter are necessarily that well-founded. I would certainly not recommend the second suggestion by Mr. Vogel that no notice shall be required for the issuance of any permit relating to a locally historic structure designated in the town center plan other than a demolition permit, because if somebody wants to alter the an existing structure, and particularly if it's an historical structure, it may involve site plan review, which would have notice provision, and I think that sentence could add some confusion. So I don't think that there may be some other substantive issues that you wanted discuss or amend, but personally, I don't think that that this one would be worthy for of tabling this town center zone tonight.
Thank you, Councilor Linnell.
Can I just ask you a quick question, Mr. Hill? Mr. Vogel's page two, that paragraph at the end of the 45-day period. Just off the top of your head, I understand what you just said. Do you have any flags raised by that paragraph that's been suggested?
Well, I'd like to, have some more time, but I think that the ordinance as written has that same implication.
Right.
The demolition permit, if it meets whatever standards are needed for a demolition permit, would issue under the proposed language as well. And maybe there could be some tinkering, but I don't see that that fear.
Thank you.
Yep.
Anybody else?
Mr. Jordan.
Yes, sir. Councilor Chappell.
I'd just like to, from what I've heard and what's been going around the chamber and what the many years that we've spent, I started with Jerry on this thing way back, and we've gone over a lot of things tonight, and I think we've made a lot of progress. I do not think personally that we need to change the filling station one at all. I like it the way it's written. I cannot see the number of cars in Cape Elizabeth over the next 50 years increasing to the point where you're going to need to fill up more than 8 at a time. And he was called over at George when we started this thing, and we got the plan that they had then about what they were going to do, and we put that in. And I think two islands with four pumps being able to pump both sides, 8 cars, is good. The washing bay doesn't bother me at all. That can be worked out. If you went for a site plan review with the planning board, why, you would hit the same things as we've written in here, that it doesn't show from the, in other words, you don't open it right on the street and the water runs on the street. That's the intent of the thing. Get down to Jim Murray's. I'm just going over these as I've heard them. If I'm wrong, why holler and scream and so forth. I think that your questions have been answered, Jim, from when you talked with me. I'm happy with what I have read and what I've seen, and I'm sure we're not going to go back on it because you've got the grievance that you can always bring up if what we say tonight is not so. You've got a point that you can bring up, and I'm sure you will. Jerry, that's the only one that I do not see and I can't find here, so I'm going to ask once more because I want it right out loud and clear. Has Jerry Murray got to have 80,000 square feet out there, or can he build on less?
According to this, if he wants to build a new single-family house, if it's on a lot, have you broken off a lot yet, Jerry?
They're all separate lots.
They're all separate lots, and how big are those lots?
The largest one is 1.2 acres, which isn't enough.
Okay, they would have to be 80,000 square feet.
Have to be 80?
80,000 square feet, which is the current RA requirement in town.
That's the only thing I've heard tonight that I have a problem with, as far as I'm concerned.
And that's something that always could be studied later and revised, too.
Councilor Dalbec.
I guess I'm a little bit Irving is on this. A lot of work has gone in. This has entailed a lot of work. And I guess my question is a process question. What's best, to go ahead and pass this and then modify the few modifications, or to, in effect, go through the whole process of trying to revise this, and goodness knows what other comments might come along in the future, but to revise this, potentially does that take us through hearings again? What would be the best process? I'm not against making some modifications if appropriate, and I would agree with Irving on the ones he's commented on. I guess I'm curious about process. Maybe it's because it's my last shot to do something on this also.
Yes, Councilor Cogshaw.
What we've found in the past is if we have an ordinance or a piece of work that's taken a lot of study and prolonged period of time and with a lot of input, that the only way you can really tell how well it actually works is to adopt it and make modifications afterwards. It's more expeditious that way because there may be more issues and you can come up with an actual package deal. In my mind, as far as Rosemary's comment, even though we do break down actual land use sections, perhaps I should ask Maureen about this, in my mind I would see that a satellite dish for a school would be acceptable, even though it doesn't specifically say school. It is under municipal.
Well, I'm not supposed to be speaking for the code officer, and so I'm not going to do that. And after this is adopted, it's the code officer who makes the interpretation. But I think that Mrs. Reed has made a good point, that because we divide up dimensional requirements into school uses and municipal uses, it does suggest that municipal uses are separate. If we had said, instead of municipal uses, institutional uses, that probably would have combined school and municipal together. But it also would have dragged in other uses, like fraternal organizations.
Thank you. I would be willing to amend my motion to include school under the satellite dishes. With my second also?
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you, Coach.
Thank you. Councilor Linnell.
I still think, there's been a tremendous amount of work has gone into this town center zone effort. There really has. And I don't think it would cramp our style any to wait another month on it. And there's about 5 points, one we've just dealt with, but there's 4 other points that have been raised. And I think I don't think it's anything that needs to drag this out for months at a time, but I think there's some issues there, and a little fine-tuning wouldn't hurt a bit. I know that in anything you do, it's really would put If these things were to be modified, these particular points, I sure wouldn't want to be on the other end of it and come back and trying to get this thing amended so forth and appeal for, or ask, apply for variations and so forth. So I think we've, I commend the committee for the work they've done, and I just think that, I think we ought to table this for, and have a work session on these issues, and when we iron them out, we can go forward with the whole thing.
Thank you. I'd like to ask the town attorney if we would have to be required for another public hearing if we went back and worked the ordinance. Would we have to go through a public hearing process again?
It really depends on the substantive changes. If it's a major overhaul, yes. If there's some minor changes, then another public hearing would not be required. I think that you can't go wrong with having another public hearing if there are changes. So it's sometimes hard to draw the line when a change is substantive or not. But for example, if tonight you amended the ordinance as proposed to have the square footage be dropped to 40,000 square feet, I doubt that that would necessitate having an additional public hearing for that change.
In your opinion, what has been discussed here, what would require a public hearing?
I don't believe that the types of changes that have been discussed, except with the possibility of Mr. Linnell's comment to allow Mr. Murray's business to be a permitted use. That one might require an additional public hearing, but the allowing school use of a satellite dish, I don't see a problem with that. I don't see a problem with dropping the minimum lot size to 40,000 square feet. I believe that's
a historic first paragraph.
Historic.
Well, the demolition permit.
Mm-hmm.
The language that Mr. Vogel has proposed would not. I don't see a problem with that either, because the ordinance doesn't require or allow someone to stop that process, the issuance of the demolition permit, by posing an objection. It merely requires that notice be given. So the burden remains the same on somebody who objects to go to court and get an injunction.
So if we pass this tonight as it's been printed and amended once, that and then we work on the demolition deal and the Murray one, we would have to go back for a public hearing for amending the ordinance, right?
Well, I think if the ordinance gets passed, if the ordinance gets passed tonight and then there's a future amendment, then that does need to go through the amendment process, which is outlined in the ordinance. I guess what I was attempting to answer, if there were amendments made tonight to the motion, that I don't think that most of what we've talked about tonight would require postponing this and having an additional public hearing. But if the ordinance gets passed and then other items are proposed as amendments later, you have to follow the ordinance amendment process.
Thank you. Anybody else? Councilor Linnell.
Yeah, I just wanted to add that, again, I think we're, 95% of the way there with this town center zone. And if we table it and had a work session, kicked around these couple ideas, it seems to me the public hearing, if we have to have a public hearing a month from now, it would be a snap. Wouldn't be much to it. And I'm in favor of doing it that way.
Thank you. Councilor Coggeshall.
Mr. Hill, if I understand you correctly, did you say that the current language in the ordinance in relation to the demolition permit for historic buildings is deals with most of the concerns of Mr. Blake's?
Yes, I think the
aunt in law.
The proposed language already addresses those issues.
Thank you. The other issue that Mr. Linnell brought up as far as Jim Murray's business, it currently is not a permitted use. It's a non-conforming use. And under this new town center ordinance, it would continue as a non-conforming use. So that, as far as actually being switched around to be a permitted use, is something that is already in the ordinance and has just been transferred to this section, and I don't see that being changed.
Well, again, I'm just concerned that it ties his hands as far as some kind of future expansion or change of use within his lot, and I think that that's something that we ought to consider just a couple more weeks. I don't think it's going to hurt any of us to talk about this issue at a workshop, and again, this is a business that's been around for a long time, and
right, which is allowed to continue. And if you wanted to have a change of use to any of the uses that are listed in this ordinance, he would go through the regular process to do it. So that's already existing. It's not going to change.
Okay. Well,
I think you're confused.
Sure.
By that letter.
Well, no.
What's confused you?
No. I had some other discussions with the town planner about this. And again, I guess, I'm not comfortable with it right now, and I'd like to kick it around in a work session. I'd feel a lot better about it, and just to take a closer look at it. And I don't think, I don't think we need to keep all these, keep everyone here tonight to work on these two or three little issues. I think we could wrap it up next time.
Councilor Mobb.
I feel that our attorney has answered the questions that I had, and I feel perfectly comfortable going ahead with this tonight. I think the committee did a fine job, and I think it's time we move the question.
Anybody else? Well, we close the public hearing, but if you've got something quick and short and want to jog up here, we'll listen. How's that? Fair enough?
Fair enough. Thank you. I just wanted to address the issue raised by the town attorney. Sorry, I don't know your name. The Gary's letter is intended to address the issue which Mr. Reese has confronted in Brooklyn Heights, Gary Vogel has confronted in the city of Portland, and that is when somebody objects, the code enforcement officer then doesn't feel comfortable taking a position and making a decision. It just gets delayed, and eventually the applicant does have to go to court to get the town council to act on that position. And that's what he's trying to avoid, is to make it clear in the ordinance what the criteria are, and that town code enforcement has to make a decision unless one or two certain things are met. He can't procrastinate because he doesn't want to make the decision because he may confront some adversity or something like that. And I hope you would delay voting on this tonight. I think you've had a good public hearing, you've had some great input, and there's nothing wrong with taking another month to get it right. Thank you.
Thank you. Ready for the question? Yes? No?
Sure.
You all understand the motion? All those in favor of item 143, you want me to read it again? Not necessary?
I don't think it's necessary.
Okay.
I don't think you want
to.
All those in favor then of the motion? Please indicate by raising your hand. 1, 2, 3, 4. All those opposed? Thank you. 4-2. I just hope we'll go to work on it and correct changes, but I see where they go. Huh? You wish to take a little break? Well,
yeah, let's take 5 minutes.
Okay.
Make sure so we can stretch.
2 minutes for stretching.
I'm ready.
We don't be listening, huh?
That's all done. I'm glad we got that passed, aren't you? Huh?
Who are you missing, Bill and Gene?
I don't know.
Oh, Gene. Oh, Gene.
I see Gene down there. And Bill doesn't come.
And you know them, Elvin.
Let's go. We would like to move on with the meeting, so if you'd like to attend, find a seat, and we'll move on.
I decided it was a little too much.
There's a guy down there with a map on. A big board. What's he called?
That's a good time to get off, I think.
We'll call a meeting back to order and move on with item 144 to consider report from the appointments committee recommending the appointments to town boards and committees and take any necessary action. I believe Councilor Linnell is going to take care of that.
I serve on the appointments committee with Councilor Marvin and Janet McLaughlin, and Janet couldn't be here tonight because of a family emergency, and so I'm afraid you're stuck with me. And we've recommended to the Thomas Memorial Library trustees Ann Carney to serve a term to 1/1/97. Ann and her family use the library extensively. She has a broad educational background and is an attorney. She's replacing Mary Beth Takach, if I'm pronouncing that correctly. Takash. To the Cable Television Advisory Committee, Madeline Anguera, to serve a term to 1/1/98. Madeline is a law student specializing in entertainment law. She is an energetic newcomer in CAPE. I would say energetic is an understatement. That's my impression. To the Arts Commission, Dana Trattner, to replace Patricia Fortunato, to a term to January 1, 1998. Dana started a term on this commission a couple of years ago, then had to step down due to work obligations. She is a practicing visual artist and looks forward to renewed involvement in the commission. To the Zoning Board of Appeals, Paul Anguera, husband of Madeline, who's on the cable, who we're recommending to the Cable Television Advisory Committee. Paul would be a strong candidate on the Zoning Board of Appeals to replace Bob Perna. Paul is a law student interested in land use issues. He is enthusiastic about being involved in the community. Also, we have recommendations for the Pedals and Pedestrians Plan Steering Committee. And I'd like to say that we had a number of very, very qualified applicants, and it was a difficult decision to narrow the applicant pool down. And having said that, I'll tell you who we've recommended. Gary Beckwith. Gary is interested and concerned about pedestrian and bicycling issues. He's certainly an avid bicyclist. Bob Schumann. Bob cares about the type and rate of change that occurs in town and feels that projects recommended by this committee can set a trend for the future. Steve Simons is also recommended for this committee. Steve feels the work of this committee is of considerable importance, both for the present and for the future. Also, Mark Toothaker. Mark is interested in gaining more information about the issues the committee will examine. John Hare. John brings experience with construction projects and a concern for safety to the committee. Sarah McCall. Sarah has a long-standing interest in health and fitness issues and the quality of life in town. Bob Bayross. Bob is interested in exploring the potential for walking and biking connections with other towns. Jim Beville would be the representative from the Conservation Commission, and Steve Etzel, a representative from the Planning Board. And those are our recommendations. We'll also have the council will discuss who would be on the committee from the council, but we're going to wait until the new council members are aboard before we do that. So I'd like to just make a motion that the recommended appointments that I just described be adopted by the council.
Second.
Been moved and seconded. Any question? Any comments? All in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed, it's a vote, 6-0. Item 145, consider approving a quitclaim deed to Norman I. and Priscilla R. Richmond for land and buildings situated at 13 Spoondrift Lane, U36-56, and take any necessary action. I believe Debbie is going to take care of that, the town clerk.
Thank you.
I called you Debbie.
In December 1994, the town foreclosed upon the Richmond property for an unpaid sewer lien. It was filed back in June of 93. Since then, we have received from the owner and actually from the mortgage holder, People's Heritage Bank, all past due and current sewer and real estate taxes for this property that totals some $5,800. At this point, I would request that you authorize the town manager to sign a quitclaim deed to release the past due sewer liens on this property.
So moved.
Second.
Been moved and seconded. Any comment? All in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed? The vote. Item 146, to consider approving a request to utilize Fort Williams Park for a vote, march, and take any necessary action. Councilman McGovern. Excuse me, Manager McGovern.
This is a...
I don't want to raise you up to...
No, you know...
The salary would be different.
Other town employees have decided to go for that lower salary, too, so... Southern Maine Boat Sport Association is looking for permission for a 6.2-mile walk. They're going to begin at SMTC, go to Fort Williams, return to SMTC, be on Sunday, October 1, 1995. This is a fine group. They've done it a couple of times before, no problems at all, and been recommended by the Fort Committee for about 200 or 300 walkers, October 1, 1995.
We got any comment? Do I hear a motion?
So moved. Somebody's got to say something.
That's right.
I'll second it.
Been moved and seconded. All in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed, it's a vote. Item 147, to consider a request from the citizens to realign the traffic island at the intersection of Old Ocean House Road and Ocean House Road, the intersection at the town center end, and take any necessary action.
Mr. Chairman, may I just bring forth a question to the council? Since I am a member of this subdivision, do you feel, even though it's not for me at all, there would be any conflict?
Personally, I don't, but if the rest of the members feel there's a conflict.
Okay, then I'll participate. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The gentleman at the podium is Stephen Moore. He represents Peter Heffenreffer and Mallory Marshall, who own property down at the intersection of Old Ocean House Road and Route 77. That, as it intersects closest to the town hall. I was approached about a month ago of the possibility of realigning the traffic island in that area so that it would eventually accommodate a change in a driveway for the two parties. You know, we've debated back and forth with Mr. Moore, other staff members, and myself as to whether or not this ought to come to the council first or to the planning board first, since it also ultimately would require planning board site plan approval for the driveway. It's my sense that whenever anyone proposes an alteration to town property in and of itself, that the council ought to at least have a look at it so that people aren't proposing altering town property to the council without the council's knowledge. The altering of our property in this case is for the traffic island, and Mr. Moore is here to explain the proposal, the reason for it, and the impacts that it will have on the traffic going through the intersection.
Thank you, Mr. McGovern. As Micah said, my name is Stephen Moore. I'm a landscape architect, and I've been working for Peter Haffenreffer and Mallory Marshall on the Henry Robinson Estate, as Mike has said, which is down just off the intersection.